A very good afternoon to all of you. I'm Ankita Chauhan from NASSCOM Product Council, and today we are about to begin the third episode from our product management webinar series. I have with me Mr. Ankur Sharma, who is Senior Director of Products in GoIBibo, and he will share his knowledge on the topic conversion rate, the one metric that matters. Ankur will present for about 40 to 45 minutes, post which we will start the Q&A session. So be curious, ask questions anytime during the webinar, and Ankur will try to take most of them at the end, keeping the time constraint of an hour in mind. And please do not forget to give your feedback to help us improve our future episodes. Over to you, Ankur.
Thanks, Ankita. Good afternoon, folks. Thanks for taking out time on a Thursday afternoon. We are going to get started with conversion rate, the one metric that matters. Or in other words, most websites don't have a traffic problem, but every website has a conversion problem. This is a legal disclaimer of NASSCOM. Please go through it. We'll skip it in 1, 2, 3 seconds now. A little bit about me. I work as a senior director of products at GoIBibo, a lead products over there. Have built a couple of line of businesses there, first hotels and now flights. Work with quite a few organizations, large and small, help them with their growth, platform issues, conversion rate challenges. Over the last 12 years, I've worked with very small, kind of out of house organization and really large organizations like Travelocity and ESPN. And I have learned a lot in these organizations, which I'm trying to aggregate and present in this presentation. I'm passionate about books, travel, and more importantly about conversion rate. My goal of this presentation is that at least one person here after this presentation ends should be as excited about conversion rate as I am. If there are any unanswered question at the end of this presentation, please feel free to write at Ankur Dinesh on Twitter, and I'll be happy to take those questions. So what are we going to talk about? We are going to talk about five things. Number one, we are going to talk about different conversion rate realms and what is conversion rate optimization. Number two, what we are going to talk about is what is the most important way to improve about our conversion rate and how can we get it right. Number three, we are going to talk about is that how can you get qualitative and quantitative triangulate to improve your conversion rate. Number four would be about mobile experiences. How are they different from web experiences and what to get right in them? Number five would be how can you use psychology, behavioral psychology, to better your products and to improve your conversion rate? So quick introduction on conversion rate optimization. It's kind of a subfield in the product management wherein you use analytics and user feedback to increase your conversion rate. It could be a step funnel, it could be your total conversion rate. Now, conversion rate in different realms could be different, right? So for a media person, for a news website like Daily Hunt, it could be a click-through rate, right? For a growth hacker, it could be for a mobile product manager, it could be an app download. For a Facebook, video product manager, it could be number of video views. For a landing page product manager, it could be the number of leads he's collecting. So there could be a different kind of realm in which conversion rate can be calculated, could have different definition in different domains. But at the end of the day, the idea is that you move from one step to another. They could be clubbed into macro conversion, which could be, the whole conversion rate of the website, purchasing a product, order is to number of shoppers. Could be micro conversion, which is that it could be a video view, could be a step funnel in the whole funnel, or could be just, adding the number of product into the basket or into the cart. Or could be just the onboarding experience, you increase your signups. So now what conversion optimization cannot fix? Conversion optimization cannot fix a bad product, right? So the premise here is that you're going to fix a product which is, you are going to fix the conversion of a product which has taken care of itself. You are not going to fix the product, which inherently is something like what you see on the screen, right? If there's no demand, which we are going to talk in a little bit of detail in the presentation forward, you really cannot fix it just by the virtue of conversion optimization. You cannot say, hey, you know what? It doesn't matter whether I have traffic or not. I'll be able to whiffle the magic of conversion optimization and increase my conversion rate. The idea is, provided you have enough traffic, provided your pricing and selection is right, provided you don't have a really poor product, you know, you are able to improve your conversion rate. So what are the ways to improve the conversion rate? Now, e-consultancy, which is one of those digital consulting companies, do this exercise every 2 years. And last 10 years, A/B testing is something which comes over and over again for every single year, right? Every single year, this is like one of the top most area wherein people say, hey, you know what? We are either using it or we plan to use it. And this is kind of the thing via which people actually either plan to use it or use it to improve their conversion rate or to increase their conversion. This is the most important way. So we are going to drill deeper into A/B testing today. We are going to look into the realities of A/B testing. So what exactly is A/B testing? If you change one thing, so there could be multiple kinds of A/B testing. This is pure play A/B testing. You have changed one thing into a variant, and you are trying to figure out whether it works or not, right? But there could be multivariate testing, wherein you have multiple variants, and you are trying to figure out which one works for you or not. A/B testing at this point in time for the large organization is the new normal. If you use Netflix, you are more often than not are in a test, right? Booking.com at any point in time runs 1,000 tests. Facebook, again, when they decided to launch their timeline, they had actually rolled out 5 versions of different timelines. Amazon, though it looks like, you know, what's there to change in Amazon? Nothing changes pretty much, right? Just on Amazon.in, the homepage keeps on changing, by the virtue of A/B testing pretty much every week. Google, again, though they have like more than 80,000 employees and they themselves get used as the QAs, they also keep running A/B test based on the different kind of countries. So for instance, there would be a different control experiment which would be run on New Zealand versus something which would be run in India. A/B testing is the new normal. What I want to do today is I want to go a little bit deeper into A/B testing, and I want to share with you some learnings which I have gotten through the years, and I have figured out that, you know what are the basic mistakes which people do in A/B testing. I'll share 4 things, right? Which are the realities which more often than not people fail to understand before they embark on the adventure called A/B testing, because you know everybody is doing it. Number one is, do you have enough traffic? So hypothetically, let's say if you have daily average visitor of 200, right? 200 people are coming on your website and you have a conversion rate of 2%. Even if you believe that an A/B test would give you a 20% jump, it'll take you 196 days to figure out whether that A/B test is successful or not. Low traffic sites, the reality of A/B testing is that low traffic site need a lot of time to declare a winner, to figure out whether that test will work or not. Having said that, the longer the test, the less reliable the outcome. For a high traffic site like Go IBO, for instance, or for that matter, you know, Netflix or Facebook, only 10 to 20% traffic, only 10 to 20% of the A/B tests actually get into production. Rest of them fail, gets iterated upon. So every time you think about doing an A/B test, make sure that you have enough traffic. You use a test calculator. There are multiple test calculators. The one which I use very often is the VWO, the link for which I have given in the presentation. And you make sure that you are doing at least 1,000 orders per month before you even embark on the A/B testing. What is the second thing? Second thing is that you don't copy your competitors, right? The most important reason why you shouldn't copy your competitor is that I'm pretty sure they themselves also don't have an idea why they are doing it. But you know, there are other ideas as well. That number one, even if you are in the same domain, your customers won't be the same. I can give you an example from my domain. Go Ibibo and Yatra, for instance, have very different kind of consumers booking on our platform. Our sites is not the same. If you would draw a heat map, the way people scroll our site is very different. So why copy a feature, or why do an A/B testing based on that feature? Our traffic is obviously not the same. There's a huge difference. UX, of course, won't be the same. Your UX designer would be the first one to tell you. And device mix would obviously be not the same. Wherein comes the third point. You should always record your device experience. What happens is, more often than not, in A/B testing, the analytics is broken. But if you actually want to get your A/B testing right, you need to start recording the device experience, the design layout. Now, it could be Google Analytics, which is what we use at Go Ibibo, but it could be anything which the analytics suite which you are using in your organization. Pretty much all the analytics suite give a capability to record different kind of design layout. Different design layouts behave differently, convert differently, have different kind of shoppers. You need to prioritize which one is converting and which one would you want to convert. And then you need to segment the result based on that, you need to declare your A/B test a winner or a failure. The fourth one is kind of a laundry list, which I have put in, which can ruin your work as well as your decision. There are kind of nine things which people do end up doing very wrongly. One is that they end up doing A/B testing at the wrong place. What you need to do whenever you are trying to do an A/B testing, you need to look for a key conversion point, right? So it could be an onboarding experience. It could be a payment page. It could be a cart. It need to be a inbound attribution. So it could be a SEO funnel, or it could be a keyword. So for instance, hypothetically in Go Ibibo, if I had to A/B test, I would say, okay, how do people come to me when they search for budget flights from Delhi to Bangalore? You need to test for a step funnel, for the forms in which I would go further in detail. And you need to test for layers of engagement. A lot of times people end up testing it at a wrong place. People end up testing whether my color is working or not, which is, by the way, a great A/B test to do in the initial phases, but it would only give you an incremental jump, not the leap which you would be looking via the A/B test. A lot of time, in fact, more often than not, people end up testing their developers instead of customers. I don't know about you, but more often than not, people don't end up A/B testing the Internet Explorer. Why? Because their developers don't use that. Having said that, if you would actually get into your analytics, you would realize there's still a substantial number of people who use Internet Explorer. Should you build a product for them? Should you A/B test your experiment on Internet Explorer? I'll leave that to you depending on how many people are using it on the Internet Explorer. But don't define your A/B test based on what your developers are using. Please go out, talk to your customers, figure out what they are doing instead of what your developers are doing, or for that matter, what you are doing. How deeper your analytics integration is. More often than not, analytics integration is only done at the level of where the A/B test product is. VW is a great product, but if your events are not being passed through your own analytics suite, in our case, for example, Google Analytics, you won't be able to track the real step funnel conversion. And hence, the test would eventually fail. And you don't test long enough. You only test till the time it actually satisfies you or it actually gives you the result which confirms your biases. You keep testing the same thing despite the test has failed. You either iterate it only minutely enough that you know it fails again, but don't actually build another hypothesis which is completely divergent, because again, confirmation bias is something which is strongly entrenched in us as product manager, for that matter, as human beings. More often than not, testing cycle is too slow. If you actually have to get the A/B test results right, the best way to the testing cycle should be at least twice over in a month. In a month, you should be able to test at least two hypotheses in the same scenarios. More often than not, it fails primarily because the testing cycle is too slow. We have spoken about it that people forget that they don't have traffic and end up doing A/B testing because everybody else is doing it. We forget that we have mobile, we have tablet, and where A/B testing is not working. I can give you multiple examples from our organization where we have done an A/B test on web, have figured out and have kind of proven a hypothesis, and then that hypothesis failed miserably when we actually implemented on mobile. When we didn't test that hypothesis via an A/B on mobile, and you know, kind of an extension of that, to see whether our A/B tests are working on all the devices or on the browsers which our customers use. So again, you have set up an A/B, right? Is it working on tablet? Is it working on mobile? Is it working on desktop? Is it working on Internet Explorer? Is it working on Safari? Could be a backend A/B, could be a design UX related A/B, but is it working everywhere where your customers are? If it is not, perhaps the time is to go back to the drawing board and say, okay, maybe I need to check all the different kind of experiences before I make a call that the product needs to be products need to be changed. I'll come to the third thing wherein I want to talk to you how qualitative and quantitative, how qual and quant triangulates. There are seven things which I want to talk to you on this. The first thing is device list. Do you know what are the top 10 devices you get traffic to? Your analytics suite has the capability, but do you know that? What is their conversion rate? Are they part of your testing checklist? Use your analytics data. It's just a 2-hour work. Make sure that it is a part of your testing checklist. All these devices are tested. How can they be tested? Either you buy them. It's very easy nowadays. Right, more often than not, you can build your own arsenal, you can buy them. If you are a startup, you do not have a capability to buy them, There are tools like cross-browser testing or browser stack, which allow you to do desktop testing. There's a device farm which Amazon provides, which can help you test multiple different kinds of devices. Just keep yourself constrained to top 10 devices. Make sure that they convert for you repeatedly. It'll help you a lot. If they are not converting for you, there's a problem in the way you are looking at the data. In the Indian context, I would suggest you go back and you check how is OnePlus converting for you, how is Xiaomi converting for you. If you can get these two converted for you right, perhaps 50% of your problem is solved. Usability testing. Again, a low-hanging fruit. There used to be a time when usability testing used to be a drone. You need to have people, you need to figure out where do you get these people. Now, if you have a concept, right from the concept level, you have tools which allow you to test the concept. You have tools like usability hub, 5-second test, which allow you to test the concept. We at GoIBibo have actually tested the concept and rejected products at a conceptualization level after doing that concept testing. We have, now let's say you have launched a product, you don't know why is it not working. It could be, a filter on your page, right? You have gone ahead with a new redesign, but you haven't gotten the uptick which you should have gotten. One of the way is to dig through the data, right? The data will tell you how, but why can easily be figured out via the usability testing. And the usability testing can easily happen via the tools like user testing, Userlytics, User Zoom. These guys basically provide you real-time users who can actually go through your website, can make videos and tell you what are the problems lie with your product. I would suggest you go to any of these tools, see a video, you will figure out yourself what I'm talking about. There are videos which tell you how users are testing apps like Airbnb and not able to find how can they filter prices. Okay, we very extensively use such kind of products apart from our own in-house usability testing lab, which we use to deep dive into very nascent user base, which have not even perhaps come to book travel at this point in time. The third point is session recording. Session recording is essentially, I haven't seen a lot many companies in India doing this, but it when you will start doing this, it'll actually open a Pandora box for you. So what does session recording does? We at our company uses Hotjar and Apsi, but all the three products are brilliant, right? What they do is they actually capture session of the user end to end, masking all the confidential information. It helps you see what the people are doing. There have been bugs which we have caught because of them, which our QAs have not been able to caught, which our developers, which our integration tests have never been able to caught. There have been buttons which become unresponsive after 5 seconds, but only after looking at Apsi session recording, which we could figure out that, this was happening. It's one of the biggest treasure trove. And if there's one thing which you want to do out of this whole presentation, I would suggest you should do this. You should try figure out, you should definitely run a customer survey. So what exactly is a customer survey? Now, whenever I speak to people about customer survey, there are two reservations which people have. One is they say people lie in customer survey. The second is people say not enough people respond. It is scientifically proven that if you get more than 96 responses, it is enough to be acted upon. So don't worry about how many people, what is the percentage click-through rate. Make sure you get 96 responses. Make sure you have regular surveys, because people do, at least my experience says, people, when you build a culture of regular surveys among your customers, they under, and you take them seriously, they understand that, you know what, it is okay to be told to tell the truth. At times incentivize them, it helps to set a precedent. They know that, okay, if I'm being incentivized, it makes sense to tell them the truth. One of the interesting thing which happened with us when we ran a survey very recently was that we actually found a competitor which were undercutting us and which could have become really big in the future, which nobody had actually found. Neither our supply could found, neither our revenue could found, but our customers were booking with us. And stuff like this would happen to you. You would found a competitive competitor to you. You would find some pesky bugs. You would find, people, where are people going and finding deals. And such kind of things would only happen when you would go and ask, which brings me to the next point, which is, install voice of customer tools. Now, voice of customer tools is conventionally a NPS tool or a CRM tool. What I would suggest is that you plug it somewhere on your website where users can see it. In our case, we have actually plugged it on our homepage, on our search results page. People see it, people provide us feedback. There have been cases where people have actually reported a broken link via this, which marketing has pushed through, and we hadn't a clue about it. So again, we use Hotjar for it. All the four products are brilliant for it. This will tell you things which you would never imagine, which you would always think that, hey, you know what, this is run of a mill. How would people actually, why would people take time to put their feedback onto it? It actually gives you a lot of understanding. Hotjar is a pretty interesting tool because it also allows you to take a screenshot of that moment. So it kind of gives you, kind of a real-time feedback, pseudo real-time feedback, if I may say. Add form analytics. Now, this is a very interesting tool which we have started exploring very recently. Now, form, more often than not, is the step just before payments. Now, this is a step wherein people have actually made up their mind. They are going to buy with you. Now, they are pretty much made up their mind, and this kind of is a friction. They have to put in their name, their email, their phone number. In case of flight, it's even bigger drone because they have to put in their passport, visa, blah, 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 blah. How do you actually remove friction can be actually gained as an insight by putting in some form analytics. Now, this is not R. This is another one which I have picked up from. But if you see, you would think passport is a problem, right? Sorry, passport is a problem, right? Because people forget their password. But interestingly, 7.1% of the people are actually dropping off at the phone number. This is a funnel of a food delivery system, wherein they are taking phone number so that they can respond if there's a problem delivering your order. They can easily circumvent it by taking the phone number during the onboarding, right? Which is how they eventually solved this problem. A lot of this form analytics is very interesting because this is a step which is the only step which needs to be solved before payment. If you can solve this step, if you can remove this friction, payment is the only step which is where you need to solve the friction then. what is the performance? How is your performance, right? Which is my last point in this case, right? So how is performance impacting? How often do you see the performance of your website as a product manager? One of the biggest challenge, at least what I have seen with the product manager, is that they test their website on Wi-Fi. Your Wi-Fi should always be switched off. At least in my case, whenever I test my product, I disable my 4G as well, and I try to test it on 3G. Jio obviously has given you a lot of luxury, but with a lot of data has come a lot of fluctuation in the data as well. Turn off Wi-Fi, there are a lot of, again, performance tools via which you should test. You should test your speed, your web pages, how fast do they load, and trust me, every second which you can shave off your page would add to your bottom line. Now I'm going to talk about the third thing, which would be the mobile experience, wherein I want to primarily speak about how mobile experience differ from the web experience. So there are largely two things. Okay, so even before I go there, let's just park our thought here and say, so one of the biggest mistake which a lot of people, when they start looking at mobile, is they start saying, hey, mobile web is same as apps. Okay, so always treat mobile web as web. Okay, now mobile, when I say mobile means apps, and web means mobile web as well as desktop. Now mobile, top of the funnel would always be greater than web, and always observe the buyer's journey. There will always be more step in the mobile, be it web or be it desktop, and hence there would be a lot more friction. Having said that, the conversion rate would always be higher because the top of the funnel in mobile would always be more. So now there's this guy called Dave McClure who had come up with something called pirate funnel. Why is it called pirate funnel? Because it is pronounced as R. Okay. So now there are two kinds of pirate funnel. There's web pirate funnel versus there's a mobile pirate funnel. How are they two different? Web pirate funnel has 6 steps. It has 3 A's and 3 R's versus mobile pirate funnel, which has 2 A's and 3 R's. The biggest difference is the awareness. So for web, you will have to build a SEO campaign. You will have to actually drive people to come to your website, which doesn't happen in mobile. You have conventional ways to get to people onto your mobile, which is ASOs, app installs, top of the mind, even if that would mean TVCs in India, and digital marketing on Facebook or on Instagram. So one of the biggest advantage on mobile is that the awareness gets shaved off. And that helps dramatically in that sense. So I'll just go through the steps quickly so as to help you understand. The web pirate funnel has awareness, wherein people would come in onto your website via either SEO or SEM. You need to help them get aware. For instance, GoIBibo had a big challenge in the beginning. People didn't used to understand what exactly does GoIBO means. Does it do travel? Then acquisition, you have to get them to sign up. You have to have them a great user experience via an activation, get them to do their first transaction. Then you have to make sure that they come back, do their second transaction. You have to make sure they do a referral either via word of mouth or via your referral programs. And then you have to continue to build a network loop on top of them. Apart from awareness, everything else applies to mobile pirate funnel as well, wherein, you know, there are different kind of growth drivers. There's a customer onboarding, activation help happens, can happen a lot more easily because you can do a one-step registration in case of mobile. In case of retention, you can do a lot of push notification. In case of referral, you can build a referral program. You can incentivize user to invite people to your app. And in case of revenue, it again, it's about what kind of deals can you push in? Can you build a personalization content on top of it? And then there are different matrices assigned to it. Mobile experiences. So now again, I've gotten back to the whole conversion rate screen, right? The biggest problem with product managers are that they need to look at all the mobile experience holistically and not granularly. If you have your top 10 devices, you need to figure out that every single device, does it work? Does it load? Can people use it? Can they read it, right? And then only, you know, everything else will work. Your referral program would only work. Your retention would only work. Because, you know, landscape, portrait, everything would only, would be, is a different experience and would only work if everything else would be taken care of. Which brings me to the to my last part of the presentation, and that is psychology or behavioral psychology. Now, there's a guy called Daniel Kahneman. He was the first non-economist to win a Nobel Prize for economics for introducing a concept called System 1 and System 2. He has also written a great book called Thinking Fast and Slow if you would want to read it. But essentially, the idea is that you know, system one is impulsive. This is where habit sets in. It's automatic. It's always on, right? While system two is creative. It allows you to imagine. It allows you to think into the future, and it is slow, right? Now, what happens in system one? System one can be exploited by fear. You know, so if you would see the screenshot here, it's by the god of some the system one activation, booking.com. You see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. At 6 places, they are trying to activate your system one. They are trying to put fear by saying this property is in, limited time offer. 3 people are looking at this moment. They are, you know, trying to appeal to your ego by saying this property is in high demand, booked 18 times today. The key is that they are trying to appeal to your impulse so that you can go ahead, you can be pushed through, and you can buy now. What works also in booking.com favor is that they don't have a payment friction. Largely, their properties are pay at hotel. When does system two works? System two works for rationally superior offering. When you have a pleasure or self-control, or let's say you want to buy a car, or if you have bought a house, wherein you are thinking, should I buy a villa or should I buy a 3 BHK? What is the price difference? You know, this is where your system two activates, because you kind of, you try to fill in a lot of new and missing information by doing a lot of research. This is where your system two activates. Now, how does it fit in the product management? The key is that you don't ever make people think. You know, you don't ever have system one and system two clash whenever you are building a persuasion, whenever you are pushing people through the funnels. Okay, and hence you have to be very careful what you are making people focus on. System one is always always on. So you should always, always be focused on system one. How can you actually activate people's system one and hopefully in a positive way by massaging their ego, by helping them understand that how this is a good decision for them to book through you or to, you know, to read through this through this newsletter or through this article, so that they can, you know, they can actually take this decision so that they can convert. Never ever have system one and system two clash. So for instance, never ever on the payment page tell the user, hey, you know what, this the prices may drop, and hence for a e-commerce funnel, fair prediction like product would always be a tricky proposition, because he would always have to think whether I should get this user converted or whether I should build a trust. There would always be a trade-off, and whenever that trade-off would be worked upon, there would be a clash between system one and system two. With this, I am done, and I would be happy to take any questions with you.
Thanks, Ankur, for this wonderful presentation. So let's just begin with the Q&A session. The first question is, do you suggest that testing should be performed post-deployment twice a month?
Okay. So, see, it depends. Depends on the product and depends on the maturity of the product, right? If the product has been conceptualized, it has been, if the usability has been done during the conceptualized phase, if you have seen there's enough traction after you have deployed, right? After you have launched, then I would suggest you start doing an A/B testing. It should never happen that there's a brand new product and you start doing an A/B testing on top of that, because that won't yield you any kind of conversion improvement. On that, I would suggest you take a step back and start doing some user testing. Okay, maybe just start asking people, if it is, for that matter, if it is not converting, you should start asking people question, you know, why is it not converting? Now, these people can be your people, people who are dropping off the funnel, or, you know, like I said in this on this slide, you can actually, you know, avail user testing or user analytics or user Zoom. So it needs to be a progressive exercise. If it's a new product, first go through the usability testing exercise and then go through the A/B testing. But if it's a mature product, I would suggest even depending on traffic, 2 or 3 or 5 A/B tests can easily be done.
All right, thanks, Ankur. The next question is by Nishant. Is it safe to test product with third-party applications, especially healthcare products?
So depends whether it's, I'm assuming in this case that they are online products, right? And more often than not, these products actually don't take any data. They would have an SDK which would sit on your system, so they're perfectly safe, as is would be in our case also. Moreover, none of your customers' data would actually go on to their system.
All right. The next question is by Deepak. What tools can be used for viewing screen recordings for app? Hotjar allows screen recording only for mobile and desktop websites.
Right. Like I said, IIM C can be used for apps. There's another one, which Decibel Insights allows you to do that. We use IIM C, but Decibel Insights also allows you to do that.
All right. Chetan has a question for you. How can we apply these learnings to early mid-stages B2B SaaS company, given most early mid-stage SaaS companies simply don't have enough volume to achieve statistical significance in few days or even weeks?
Talk to customers. Talk to as many people as you can. Session recording works for even for five customers. Customer surveys work for them as well. So see, the second part of this, which is qual with quant, right, pretty much work for the smaller cohort as well. Obviously, you don't need a device list for small size B2B SaaS company, but you can have a session recording, you can have a usability testing, you can run a customer survey, you can have a voice of customer. But most importantly, at this point in time, you need to speak to as many customers as you can. One of the biggest mistakes which happens is that product managers try to build products sitting in office.
All right. Suman has a question for you. How do you know how much push notification is optimal? Because as an app user, there have been times I have uninstalled apps or just ignored the content because it was too frequent.
Right. So again, this in itself could be and is an A/B test scenario, wherein you can actually take a 5% of your traffic, or for that matter, even 1% of your traffic is large enough, and continue to tweak, continue to say if they would start uninstalling at 10 push notification a day, or 2 push notification a day, or 5 push notification a day, and you can easily run that control experiment. Having said that, it is a lot dependent on what kind of content do you push. Now, if you're a travel company, more than 2 perhaps would be a lot, right? But if you are a content company, right? If you are, let's say, Daily Hunt or for that matter, a Facebook, right? People wouldn't mind getting a 7 push notification. So it's very context-based. Number one, I would suggest the best way to get this answer is to actually do a test and figure out do a test on a control group wherein you can actually find an inflection point. You can say, okay, post this, people would stop responding to my notification, or for that matter would start uninstalling. We have done these kind of experiments, so I can tell you confidently that this is a very good A/B test scenario.
All right. Pranav is asking that, how can we improve day one retention? What is GoIBibo's day one retention?
Okay, I cannot tell you what is GoIBibo's day one retention, but I can tell you what is... how can you improve day one retention? The key is to, again, a lot of it depends on which industry you are in. But if you are in e-commerce industry, the key is to get people to transact. Okay. If you can get people to transact on day one, or for that matter, on day zero, your day one retention would be very high. Okay. If you are in, for that matter, if you are in... content company like ESPN or Daily Hunt, your goal should be that the user should have read through at least should have done at least 5 page views by day one. So these are optimal matrices to track for day one cohorts.
All right. Manish has a question, a little lengthy one. What is an acceptable conversion rate for B2B businesses when the leads are coming through inbound marketing? And as per my experience, conversion rate can be improved by sending out offers and promo offers, but that leads to low quality leads and overall the brand value also goes down. how to maintain a balance between quantity versus quality?
Right. So a lot of it depends on what is your business model, what is your monetization model, right? So if you are selling these leads, irrespective of what their quality is, so there could be two kinds of business model built around the leads. One is that you use these leads for yourself. Number one is you take these leads and sell them further, right? If you are using these leads for yourself, obviously the goal should be the quality. There you should you should actually experiment with different kinds of incentives. We had done this exercise while I was at Holiday IQ, and we realized that the best incentive which works is, and it's kind of very interesting experiment which we did. The best kind of incentive which actually works and which helps us get good quality is t-shirt and mugs. Everything else doesn't work. So a Paytm voucher doesn't work, a Book My Show voucher doesn't work, cashback doesn't work. A lot of other stuff which we tried doesn't really work, but a t-shirt and a mug works. Helps generate good quality leads, help these guys come back to us. It's a B2C realm, so obviously these things would be different in your case. But again, you will have to try different kind of experiments, different kinds of products, or different kind of incentives in your case. Right now, if it is number two, wherein you are procuring leads and selling it further, you will have to make sure that there is enough quantity along with the quality, wherein you will actually have to build a product on your side so that you can define, you can say, okay, these are hot leads and these are non-hot leads. Hot leads can again be differentiated based on the incentives which you give them. Again, you will have to find a better way to incentivize people and not just coupons. And non-hot leads could be gained by giving them a lower incentives or an incentive which doesn't really work in building the retention.
All right. The next question is, do you recommend to move users thinking from system two to system one, or play to its own space based on the business slash product?
So a lot of it depends on which business you are in. If you're selling cars, the user would be in system two, but I am assuming that nobody attending this webinar, this is a safe assumption, hopefully, nobody attending this webinar would be selling cars online. But if you are selling a hotel or a flight, or for that matter, even a t-shirt or a shoe online, would need to appeal to the system one, because these are impulse purchases. And you need to have the user to push through the steps, to go through the next step, wherein it is easy for him to take that choice now, today, at this point in time, rather than going back and say, should I or shouldn't I? Okay, I have two more days, let me think about it, which is what happens in case of car or houses. In case of cars and houses as well, I would suggest you should always try to appeal to system one, because it is always on. But even if you decide that, you know what, in case of cars and houses, appealing to system one is a dark pattern and we want to stay with system two, never ever try to create a clash. Never ever say that, okay, I will appeal to his system two only. I will give him a lot of information. I will allow him to come back, but I'll also show him persuasion that only five cars left. That will create a lot of confusion in his mind and he will definitely drop off.
All right. The next question is single page sign up good or multi page sign up?
See, what happens is that if you are Google or Facebook, you can, one of your biggest advantages, you can actually help people build habits. What Google has done by moving from single page signups to multi-page, or rather step onboarding funnel, is that it has gotten people used to that step signups. Now, there's no magic bullet. You cannot really say whether single page signup is good or step signup is good. Having said that, it is always good to appeal to users' predictability. And at this point in time, users' predictability is what Google and Facebook appeal present to him. At this, and so since Google has moved to multiple step signup, I would suggest at this point in time, multiple signup would work better as against the single step signup.
All right. Tarun has a question. What are the best strategies to move traffic from website to mobile app?
Incentivize. Give a cheaper rate on mobile, or have a lesser service fee on mobile and call it out on website. At the time when user is trying to take a decision, very early in the funnel, perhaps on the product page, perhaps on the search page itself.
Mm-hmm. Manish is asking, we are into building e-commerce and mobile apps for startups and SMBs. Any suggestions?
It's a very open question. Maybe you can write to my Twitter handle and we can talk about it. But I'm sure they would be doing a lot of stuff which I spoke about today. So it's a very open question. I'm sorry. As of now, I won't be able to suggest anything.
All right. They'll surely be connecting you through Twitter. The next question is, which app sign up mechanism working well? Is it WhatsApp or mobile based OTP verification, or via Facebook or Google?
Mobile based OTP.
All right. System 1 and 2 both are merged to a large extent, especially in health coaching / training services. I guess Soumya was trying to just make a remark out of it, not a question. Okay. I think more or less we are done with the there is also one question. If a product will be available on both website and mobiles, where should we launch first?
You should, if you have enough distribution money, then you should launch on mobile.
All right. Let's take this as a last question, because we are about to, the 60 minutes time is about to get over. So this will be the last question, Ankur. What's the time you consider for your conversion funnel? Is it within the same session or longer, given that travel has some additional consideration time?
We take 4 hours. Hours for a user.
All right. Let's just take one more question, because Tarun is time and again he's asking, what are the best product listing recommendation hacks from your experience to boost conversions?
Show the persuasion on the product listing. Like I said, appeal to user system one. Show the final price on the product listing. Don't show the final price on the product listing. Add the taxes or the service fee at the last, because that actually increases your that increases your mouth of the funnel enough to offset the people who drop off at the end of the funnel. What else? Have a huge book now, a huge call to action. Don't assume that people will click on the without a button. And this I'm talking in terms of web. In case of app, make sure that you are able, you are calling out offers right on the search results page. It's okay not to have filter very, it's okay not to have filters very prominently. People don't use a lot of filter. People scroll a lot. Both on web and mobile, Facebook have made people used to scrolling. What else I can think of? A/B test a lot. That's all I can think of. Yes. Yeah, use a lot of colors. Yes, use a lot of colors to attract people attention, but don't make it rainbow.
All right. For the remaining questions, I request all of you to please connect with Ankur via Twitter so that, because we are about to, finish up the session. So thank you, Ankur, for this interesting presentation, really a detailed one with examples which were really amazing. I'm sure the audience must have liked and learned something new today. And the book, Thinking Fast and Slow, I second you. It is a great read. And we have another webinar tomorrow with the title, Are You Wasting Money with Your Approach to Customer Engagement, between 3 to 4 p.m. by Mr. Vikas Malhotra, Business Unit Head, Customer Engagement and Support. Log me in. To register for the same, please visit the NASSCOM homepage and click on the first banner. To stay tuned on NASSCOM events and webinars, please visit nascom.in/events. And thank you, Ankur, for your time and efforts and for this wonderful presentation. Thank you all. Thank you, everyone.
Thanks, Ankita, and thanks, guys, for listening.
Thank you.